Good morning.
Good morning.
The hardy ones are here. It was, I don't know what at your house, but it was 19 degrees at my house and 20 degrees in my car when I got in this morning. But thank you all for being here. I really do appreciate y'all being here for worship. We have our annual meeting is scheduled for next week. I know that we may be doing it by Zoom instead of having everybody together. You will get an email about that after the vestry. We'll get it out to you tomorrow, but the vestry and I are going to talk about that decision today and see how we want to do things. But that'll be right after the 10:30 service. We'll send you all information. If it's going to be by Zoom, everybody will get an invitation to come in and be part of it. We have to have a minimum of 25 people, according to our bylaws, in order to have a quorum. That's the way that it was set. That's the way it's set up. So once we have that, once I can get the count and get the quorum, then we'll go ahead and begin the meeting. All right. Are there any other announcements for the good of the community? I will be away most of this week. I've got a clergy conference at Camp St. Christopher, and then I have to go back down to Camp St. Christopher again on Saturday for a Priscilla meeting, but I will be around. If you need me for anything, please don't hesitate, call me or text me and let me know if there's anything that you need. If there's an emergency, please make sure you contact the church office or contact me. There's no other way that I can know they didn't give me a crystal ball in seminary. So if there's something going on that you need my assistance, please let me know. And I can, under those circumstances, leave the clergy conference. So I'm always available. And please let others know that as well. Okay?
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
A reading from the book of Nehemiah, chapter 8, beginning with the first verse. All the people came together as one in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra, the priest, brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak until noon, and he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra, the teacher of the law, stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. Beside him on his right stood Mattadiah, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, and Messiah, and on his left were Pedaiah, Mishael, Mikiah, Hashem, Hashbadana, Zechariah, Meshulam. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them, and he opened it. As he opened it, the people stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, Amen. Amen. Then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites, Jeshua, Bani, Sarabiah, Jamin, Achim, Shephathiah, Hadiah, Messiah, Kalita, Azariah, Josabad, Hanan, and Peliah instructed the people in the law while the people were standing there. They read the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read. Then Nehemiah, the governor, Ezra the priest, the teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people said to them all, "This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep." For all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, "Go and enjoy choice food and drinks, and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is holy to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." The Levites calmed all the people, saying, "Be still, for this is a holy day. Do not grieve." Then all the people went away to eat and drink, to send portions of food to celebrate with great joy, because they now understood the words that had been made known to them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm selected for this morning is Psalm 113, found on page 756 in the Book of Common Prayer and in your bulletin. We will say it responsively by half verse. Hallelujah! Give praise, you servants of the Lord.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Let the name of the Lord be blessed.
From this time forth forevermore.
From the rising of the sun to its going down.
Let the name of the Lord be praised.
The Lord is high above all nations.
And his glory above the heavens.
Who is like the Lord our God, who sits enthroned on high?
Who speaks to the whole heavens and the earth.
He takes up the weak out of the dust.
And lifts up the poor from the ashes.
He sets them with the princes.
With the princes of his people.
He makes the woman of a childless house.
To be a joyful mother to children.
A reading from the first book of Corinthians, chapter 12, beginning with the 12th verse. Just as a body, though one has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free. And we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. Now, if the foot should say, "Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body," it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. And if the ear should say, "Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body," it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. And if they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say, "Hand, I don't need you." And the head cannot say to the feet, "I don't need you." On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And the parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with special honor. And the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty, while our presentable parts need no special treatment. But God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the parts that lacked it, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You are love, you bring light.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread to the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. He began by saying to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Everyone who enjoys reading loves an author that develops a story and writes it very well. It doesn't matter whether the work is a fantasy, a murder mystery, an historical piece, a courtroom drama, or a thriller of some sort. What matters is that the author constructs the story so well that the reader is drawn into the book, enjoying every character the author has created and every theme the author is attempting to convey. Some of the authors I have personally enjoyed reading because of those reasons are C.S. Lewis, J.R.R. Tolkien, J.K. Rowling, and Tom Clancy. I read a wide variety of things. And yet, I often wonder how many of us think of the books of the Bible in this manner. Of course, there are multiple writers of the various books. Some of them were better authors than others. But one wonderful example of an excellent writer and an author is the writer of the Gospel of Luke. This author is well educated in the Greek language. His writing is in a classical Greek style, using excellent grammar. Most of all, he deliberately sets his goal to write an orderly and accurate account concerning Jesus Christ. Not only does he want to write this accurate account, though, he wants the reader to know who Jesus is. By the end of the book, he wants the reader to know and believe that Jesus is the Son of the living God. In addition, he expects the reader to understand what Jesus has come to do and what he has accomplished. And today's reading is an excellent example of how this author will accomplish his task. One of the first ways he assists the reader in understanding who Jesus is occurs in the way he opens and closes sections of the narrative that he is sharing. It is very subtle, and the reader can look over it very easily. But he uses geographical notices to clue the reader that something new is going to occur. And in the reading this morning, the author informs us that Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee. This single sentence reminds the reader that Jesus has just returned from the temptations in the wilderness. He is now coming back into the cities and towns of the area of Galilee. In doing so, in writing it this way, the author is informing the reader of the end of one section, which were the temptations, and the beginning of another, the beginning of Jesus' ministry. Furthermore, he keeps one of his major themes of his entire book in front of the reader, and that theme is the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit of God. The reader is introduced to the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit at Jesus' Annunciation, where the angel told Mary that she was going to conceive. All right? Now the reader is to see that the Holy Spirit is present with and empowers Jesus at the beginning of his ministry. The Spirit will be with him at all times, in all of his teachings and in all of his actions. In addition, the author also introduces two other themes that will be seen throughout his ministry. The first one is Jesus' teaching, specifically teaching in the synagogue. And as he moves throughout Nazareth, Capernaum, and Judea, he will constantly be in the synagogues, teaching in various ways. Secondly, he shares with the reader the response of many of the people to Jesus' teaching, to his healings, and to other miracles. And that response is praise, just like the song we just sang. At the end of the second verse of the reading, the author writes, "And he was praised by everyone." Now, of course, we know that there were people who didn't like Jesus. We get that. But when Jesus begins his ministry, people are astounded by what he was doing and saying. And his works were universally acclaimed by those who witnessed and received them. And they praised God, which is the only appropriate response to God's work in our lives. So just in these first two verses of the reading today, we, the readers, are introduced not to one thing or two things, but to four themes of Jesus' ministry in Galilee. The first one is the nature of Jesus' work, teaching. There's a second one, a common setting for his teaching, the synagogue. The third one, the source of his power, the Holy Spirit. And the fourth one is the result of his work within us, which is praise. So we can see that this author has chosen every word very well. The structure of each phrase is important, but all of his work is to proclaim to the reader the true identity of Jesus. And as we go further into the reading of today, the author reinforces these themes and he shares more themes with us. Once again, we see a change in where Jesus is. In the next verse, he's now in Nazareth. Whenever we see the name of a town where Jesus is going to be, we need to pay attention. It is the Sabbath. Where does Jesus go on the Sabbath? To the synagogue. We know now that we can expect a teaching moment. The author has clued us in. And once again, we don't know a great deal about first century religious practices in the synagogue. We are fairly certain that some of these elements were present in the service. The reciting of the Shema and the Decalogue, the 18 benedictions, a reading of scripture, the Psalms were also read, an exposition and a blessing. By the first century, there was a triennial cycle of readings from the Torah. There was an assistant in the synagogue. His title was the Hazan. He would have handed the reader of the scriptures for that day the appropriate scroll. The readings would have been in Hebrew, and the interpretation would have been in Aramaic. There was usually more than one reading, and each reading was expected to have at least three verses. And readings from the prophets were common because they had substantial connections with the Torah. So, do we get a little bit of an idea of where our service structure comes from? The manner in which Luke describes this event implies that Jesus specifically chose the particular passage from Isaiah that he read. What we might not know is that what Jesus read is from two different parts of the book of Isaiah. Verses 18 and 19 are actually from Isaiah 61:1 and 58:6. But the question we have to ask is why Jesus read these two passages from Isaiah. Well, first of all, reference to the anointing of the Spirit connects this passage to Jesus' baptism and the description of the work of God's anointing prophet. When Jesus reads that particular anointing of the Spirit, he is telling people plainly who he is. They may not understand it, but he's telling them who he is. It also perfectly serves as the counterpoint to Jesus' temptations. He did not sin where others, everyone, all of us, fall short. Secondly, the author chose to use the words, "He has sent me." The choice of this phrase is important because it leads us into a more exact description of Jesus' ministry. Jesus has come to do four things: to bring good news, to proclaim, to let go free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Each of these four actions of Jesus are explained and described more fully in this gospel. So Jesus has been sent to bring good news. Luke specifically says to the poor. Throughout this gospel, Jesus constantly responds to the poor. Mary in the Magnificat will praise the Lord for lifting up the lowly and sending the rich away empty. Jesus proclaims God's blessings constantly on the poor and the needy. In this gospel, Jesus' teaching concerning the poor is more prominent than any other writing. And the phrase to let go free has many meanings. As we know, Jesus released people from many maladies and oppressions, including economic, meaning the poor, physical, such as the lame, the crippled, and the lepers, political, referring to those who are condemned, and the demonic, those who are oppressed by Satan's demons. Throughout the gospel, Jesus lets people go free of the various chains and bonds that ensnare them. Jesus also will release people from blindness, but that freedom has a slightly different connotation. While it is restoring physical sight to those who can't see, it is also associated with fulfilling God's prophetic promise to Israel. Jesus is fulfilling the role in which Israel failed. He is being the light to the nations. Israel was supposed to be a light to the nations. They were supposed to draw the nations to God. Instead, they started holding God to themselves. Sometimes we do the same thing, don't we? But every action and word of Jesus is to fulfill the role that he is to be the light to the nations. Furthermore, any follower of Jesus is also to be a light to those around them. We are, as the commentary stated, I thought this was an interesting sentence, a minor prophet of God's love in Jesus Christ. Think about that for a minute. What does it mean to be a minor prophet? It means we're to go out and share good news. That's all it means. Finally, Jesus reads the words of Isaiah to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Now, what Jesus means is that his presence and his ministry show that the time for the liberation of those who are poor and oppressed has come. For them, the year of Jubilee has arrived. They were free of their debts. They were free of being servants. They were free in the eyes of their loving God. And yet, while we might see these words as describing only Jesus' ministry, the author uses them to inform us of who Jesus is and who we are as his followers. You see, Jesus did not come just for the Hebrew people. He came for all people. The poor, the homeless, the hungry, the naked, and the ashamed. All need Jesus. And even though they might not be aware, so do the well-fed, the rich, or even moderately comfortable, the well-clothed, and especially those who hold themselves in high esteem. They need Jesus too. Jesus is not the Savior for a select few, but for the entire world. And anyone who believes in him has the opportunity to live eternally with him in the heavenly realms. Anyone who believes only in themselves needs to think twice. Jesus and only Jesus is the way to eternal life. And we have a responsibility. We say we are believers in Jesus. As we look around us, you can tell which group we're in. I haven't missed many meals recently. I may dress in these funny clothes for services, but I'm well dressed underneath. I managed to get around okay in my vehicle. I've got a nice warm place to sleep. My responsibility is to take the word of God out into this world around me. It's all of our responsibility. And at the same time, we ought to reach out to the poor, the naked, the lame, the people today that we might call lepers. We are to be the light of Christ in the world around us. There's a song that I love called St. Teresa's Prayer. And the first verse says, Christ has no body now but yours. No body now on earth but yours. You are the eyes through which he sees compassion on this world. Christ has no body now on earth but yours. I pray that this day that we can be a light of God's love in the world around us. To be bold, to go to places where we might not like to go. To be with people that are not in our normal circles. But that we take on the responsibility that Jesus has given us to share the word of God boldly, by word and by deed. Amen. Would you please turn to page 6 in your bulletin and let us reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us is our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified on the mount of Calvary. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism and forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead. The life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for our church and for the world. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetually shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and for those of others.
We pray especially for those on the parish prayer list, on the Daughters of the King prayer list, and for those who are foremost on our hearts and minds this day. For Bob, Elise, Bill and Jean, Tom and Marie, Tim and Penny, Jim, Michael, David, John, unknown Bart. We also ask you, Lord, to please protect those who are first responders in our hospital systems, in our school systems. We pray for wisdom for those who are working on various ways to address the issue of the virus that keeps us apart. We pray for wisdom and determination and strength. We also offer thanksgivings for those celebrating birthdays in the coming week. Nancy McGee, Remy Rogers, Gwen Sanikasov, Lindy Leptak, and Richard Nall. We pray, Lord, that you will continue to be with them and to hold them in your loving hand where they may grow in their knowledge and love of you. O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, a lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. At the top of page 8 in your bulletin, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have not done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand. Greet one another in the name of the Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I think everybody here has been through communion already at least once, so we don't need to worry, we don't need to talk about how we're going to take care of communion. Just give me a moment to please set the table. I do want to read the offertory sentence to you. I believe the appropriate one for today comes from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 12th chapter, the first verse. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship.
Thank you.
Bible, page 8 of your bulletin. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father, Almighty Creator of heaven and earth. Because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him, and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thank you.
Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all persons. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.